I'm very grateful to Professor Sobhanlal Datta Gupta and to the director and staff of the Max Mueller Bhavan Goethe-Institut, Kolkata, for inviting me to speak here today on Hannah Arendt, a philosopher whom I greatly admire, though an audience of some philosophers, some political scientists, makes me feel that I am unworthy to speak on such a figure in this assembly. And I welcome questions, comments, and emendations where I may seem to be presuming on territory that is not my own. I consider Arendt as one of the leading political philosophers of the 20th century, but it is not easy to contain her within a single ideological or philosophical worldview. And I have circulated, would you like to put this up? First slide, please. I have circulated a very brief account of what I want to do in these two lectures, and I have also circulated some reading material. I was asked to keep the reading material within the limit of 35 pages of printed text, and therefore they represent only a very small sampling of Arendt's work, and may indeed seem to some of you to be unrepresentative. There is also the question of access, availability, and what I can put into the, you know, the public domain. This photograph by Fred Stein is known to many of you. It's one of a series of photographs of philosophers in exile that he took in the 1940s in New York. And it's a very famous photograph, this one, of Hannah Arendt. Also, let me say that I have not watched the film Hannah Arendt, directed by Margareta von Trotter, released last year. So there is no point in asking me about it, though Shantanu sent me a link to the trailer. I can't even say to you, in the immortal lines used by a Bible salesman after the phenomenal success of Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments, "You've seen the film, now read the book." let me begin with a brief, very brief account of Hannah Arendt's life, though I find that such a life has already been provided for you in the files that have been given to the participants. This is simply in order to place her within a certain context, particularly in history, and it will be the work of others really to place her properly in a tradition of philosophy. Hannah Arendt was born in Hanover in Germany in 1906, that is 108 years ago. And she died in New York in 1975, which seems not all that long ago, given that I myself completed my postgraduate studies in that year, 1975. For us, children of the catastrophic 20th century, as many of you, irrespective of when you were born, are children of the 21st. Arendt seems a thinker who is both very close and frighteningly distanced by the events that she witnessed in the first half of that century before we were born, before I was born. Arendt began her philosophical studies at the University of Marburg with Martin Heidegger, with whom she had a love affair. Brief and intense is the usual nomenclature, ending when she moved the following year, just after a year, she moved to Freiburg, where she attended Edmund Husserl's lectures. Subsequently, in 1926, so this is within the space of 3 years, in 1926 she went to Heidelberg and became Carl Jaspers' student, and formed a deep friendship and intellectual partnership with him. In 1929, she completed her doctoral dissertation under his supervision on the concept of love in St. Augustine, And so far as I'm aware, this has not been translated into English. Now, as you can see then, her early philosophical influences are existentialist, phenomenological, and we should not forget this, Augustinian. And these are major strands in the philosophy of the early 20th century. Jaspers is sometimes described as a Christian existentialist, but this is not, in my view, an appropriate label. In his essay on my philosophy, Jaspers said that Kant became the philosopher for me and has remained so. And I think that a lot of this discussion is going to be about Kant. And I think that we have to see Jaspers as preoccupied through his life with the Kantian antinomies and the problems of freedom, decision, and faith. Now, I will suggest that Arendt shares some of these Kantian preoccupations, preoccupations with freedom, with decision, and with knowledge, though perhaps not so much with faith. And faith is important to Jaspers in a way that it never was for Arendt. Arendt's last work on judging, which was the third volume of her large philosophical work, the work that she was occupied with in the last years of her life, The Life of the Mind, of which two volumes were completed, On Thinking and On Willing. This third volume, projected as On Judging, was posthumously published in the form of lecture notes and background material as Lectures on Kant's Political Philosophy. And this was in 1982, 7 years after her death. Arendt fled Hitler's Germany in 1933, going to Prague, Geneva, and finally to Paris, where she stayed till 1939, working for Jewish refugee organizations, writing a biography of the early, that's 18th, 19th century, Jewish female intellectual, Rahel Varnhagen. And she also came to know Walter Benjamin. During this period, in 1936, she left her first husband, Günther Stern, for the poet and philosopher Heinrich Blücher, whom she married in 1940. In 1941, she moved to New York with her husband and her mother, and she became part of the intellectual circle around the journal Partisan Review, which again, you know, this sort of intellectual circle around a journal is very much part of the culture of early modernism. And ultimately, she was professor of political philosophy at the New School of Social Research in New York. And that is an important part of her identity, although she also taught in various other universities like Princeton and Stanford and Chicago and so on. Throughout her career, she corresponded with major philosophers like Heidegger. The publication of the Heidegger Arendt correspondence reasonably recently also put a fresh complexion on much of her thought, with Jaspers, with Benjamin, so long as Benjamin was alive, of course, and Mary McCarthy, among others. The McCarthy correspondence is also extremely interesting. She published The Origins of Totalitarianism in 1951 and The Human Condition in 1958. In 1961, The New Yorker magazine sent her to Jerusalem to cover the trial of Adolf Eichmann, ending in his execution on the 2nd of May, 1962. And her reports were published as Eichmann in Jerusalem in 1963. The reports and the book were attacked both in Israel and by Jewish circles elsewhere. And we'll come back to Eichmann in Jerusalem, which is one of the texts, and I have circulated one chapter, chapter 8 of Eichmann in Jerusalem, so I will come back to that. But let me just quickly mention her other works. She published On Revolution also in 1963, On Violence in 1969, as well as collections of essays like Between Past and Future in 1961, revised in 1968, and Men in Dark Times in 1968, and there are other books like Crisis of the Republic and so on. Before her death in 1975, she had written, as I said, the first two volumes of her last major philosophical work, The Life of the Mind. Now, I will not start with the origins of totalitarianism, though this is the first subject. Let's just keep the abstract up there. You have the abstract, it should have been circulated to you. It's just a reminder of what we want to do in these talks, and also a reminder of the fact that since these talks are really linked to material that I have circulated, I am trying not to give you a kind of formal, prepared lecture on Arendt's life and work. Though I have given you a very, very brief conspectus of the work, of the life, sorry, I will try to go, to focus on the material that I've circulated, to look at what the problems are raised in those particular texts and whether they can throw light on what we think of as Arendt's general philosophical position or her political ideology. Now, I'm not starting with the origins of totalitarianism, though I will have occasion to refer to one chapter of this major work, and the chapter to which I will refer, I wanted to circulate it, but it went over the 35-page limit, which is Total Domination. It's a chapter in close to the end of the origins of totalitarianism, pages 437 to 59 of the Meridian Books edition of 1958, and an e-text of that edition is available on the net, so I haven't even bothered to sort of copy it and that chapter, Total Domination, is one that I may try to come to. But I want to start by looking at the problems outlined by Arendt in chapter 8 of Eichmann in Jerusalem, because this is a text that I have circulated, and it is in some ways at the core of what is most controversial and important in that book, justifying its subtitle, A Report on the Banality of Evil. Now, I assume that all of you, most of you, are familiar with this background history. Nevertheless, just for the odd person who might not be, I'm just saying what this book is about, what is the occasion for the book. Adolf Eichmann was Obersturmbannführer, that is a lieutenant colonel, in the paramilitary SS in Nazi Germany, working under his superior officer, Reinhard Heydrich, to organize the mass deportation and extermination of Jews in Germany, Poland, and Hungary. Eichmann escaped to Austria and later to Argentina after the war, and he was captured by the Israeli Mossad and brought to Jerusalem for a highly publicized trial followed by execution in 1961-62. Let me note that the capture of Eichmann in this extrajudicial way, the kidnapping of Eichmann from Argentina and the bringing of him over forcibly to bodily to Israel to stand trial, was a matter that raised deep questions of legality and conscience, both for Karl Jaspers and Hannah Arendt, though in fact Arendt consented to the execution, that is to say, the sentence of execution that was passed upon Eichmann at the end of his trial was one to which she gave her moral consent. Nevertheless, the circumstances of the trial and the way in which the trial was made a matter of national politics, that's to say, it was the nation state, in the newly formed Zionist nation state of Israel, that was putting Eichmann on trial, not an international war crimes tribunal. This was a matter of deep disquiet to both Arendt and Jaspers. Let me also note here that his superior, who is regarded really as one of the most evil men in Nazi Germany, Reinhard Heydrich, gifted musician, violinist, extraordinary person, regarded as the soul, the Iron Man of Nazi Germany, was in fact assassinated in Czechoslovakia in 1942, I think it was, 1942, by a small British and Polish-trained group. And after his assassination, suspicion fell upon the populace of two probably innocent Czech villages, and the Nazis ordered the complete extermination of the population of those villages by direct mass killing of all adult males over the age of 16, and deportation and ultimate killing also of the women and children, so that only a handful survived of the population of these two villages. So I mention this because in the text, Eichmann in Jerusalem, there is also a great deal of discomfort and anxiety about the duty of resistance and what the Jews could have gained or not gained by resisting or standing up to Nazi plans for their deportation or extermination. Now, chapter 8, this chapter that I have circulated, is called Duties of a Law-Abiding Citizen. And the title is ironic, obviously, but it also points to a necessary distinction between order and law, one that defines the totalitarian state as distinct from others. Why is Eichmann, even ironically, described as a law-abiding citizen? According to his own explanation, he was doing his duty. He obeyed orders, and he also obeyed the law, which was based on the Führer's order. And I will now turn to this text. Let me just move to the next slide. That's fine. Just leave it on there for a short while. Yes. So this is, I think, something like 9 pages, and I have actually sort of copy-pasted them in order to try to get as much as possible into my 8-9 page limit. So let me just take a look at what Arendt is saying here. Eichmann says that he obeyed the law and he also obeyed orders. Now, and the law was based, so he knew, on the Führer's order, that is, on Hitler's order. Now, I quote Arendt here, Eichmann had a muddled inkling that this could be an important distinction, but neither the defense nor the judges ever took him up on it. As a result, so what is the distinction? The distinction is between order and law. And there is a certain kind of argument which was brought up by defense lawyers in the Nuremberg trials also repeatedly, that when a junior officer in a regimented force like the army or the police is carrying out the orders of his superior, then he is bound to obey orders. There was also, of course, the question of whether one is bound to obey a manifestly unjust order, or whether one should have an inner moral determination of what constitutes a just and an unjust order. Further, what is the relation of the order to the law? Now, the Arendt says that Eichmann's thinking on this issue is on the whole very muddled. And he ended up by stressing alternately the virtues and vices, I'm quoting again, of blind obedience or the obedience of corpses. And this is a quotation from the German, Kadaver Gehorsam, as he himself called it, the obedience of corpses. And there's a critical moment here, and that's why I said a little bit about Arendt's lifelong interest in Kant. There is a critical moment here on which chapter 8 focuses. Eichmann, at a point during the trial, comes out with a surprising statement that he had lived his life according to Kantian principles. And what was this Kantian principle? It was, of course, the Kantian categorical imperative, the moral imperative, the categorical imperative. And what is this? This is, of course, he was asked by the judge to define, because the judge was so interested to hear Eichmann say this, that he asked him to define what he meant by a Kantian principle. And he came up with a reasonably correct statement of the Kantian categorical imperative, which was first articulated in Kant's Grounding for the Metaphysics of Morals, and then became, as you know, really the cardinal premise of the Critique of Practical Reason. Groundwork for the Metaphysics of Morals was published in 1785, and the Critique of Practical Reason in 1788. So what is this? It is act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time will that it should become a universal law. So act as though the principle of your action were a universal law or had the capacity to become a universal law. And we all know how, you know, this is explained in Kant, that is to say, a thief cannot will that the principle of his action should become the principle of universal law, because then he would be subject to theft from everybody else. So the illegality of theft is made clear by the fact that we might want to steal for ourselves, but we cannot will that it should become universal. Now, that is the Kantian categorical imperative, and apparently Eichmann came up with a fairly clear repetition of this, and he said that he had read the Critique of Practical Reason. But then he went on to say that from the moment that he was charged with carrying out the final solution, he had ceased to follow the Kantian imperative, and he knew this. But he was unable to change it. This is his feeling, that he was helpless, and therefore he became very muddled, because on the one hand he says he's a Kantian, on the other hand he feels that he was not able to be a good Kantian right through. And now Arendt is obviously very indignant at this use of Kant to bolster Eichmann's very questionable moral position, and she enters into a kind of angry debate with Eichmann in the text of the work. She says that, and this is beyond the simple incredulity of the judge who examined him. And she says that in fact Eichmann acted only as if the principle of his own actions were the same as the law of the land. That is, and what was the law of the land? It was the will of the Führer. So she cites Hans Frank's formulation of the categorical imperative under the third Reich: act in such a way that the Führer, if he knew your action, would approve it. That is the Kantian categorical imperative according to Nazi Germany. That is Hans Frank's statement of it, and Arendt repeats it here. Now, Arendt goes on sharply to say that Kant, to be sure, had never intended to say anything of the sort. On the contrary, to him, every man was a legislator the moment he started to act. By using his practical reason, man found the principles that could and should be the principles of law. But it is true that Eichmann's unconscious distortion, and this is Arendt continuing with what Arendt is saying, it is true that his unconscious distortion agrees with what he himself called the version of Kant for the household use of the little man. That is to say, if a person is not gifted with a great deal of intelligence or moral sense, then he must have a kind of handyman version, everyday version of Kant, which will help him take his decisions in real life. So, in this household use, all that is left of Kant's spirit is the demand that a man do more than obey the law, that he go beyond the mere code of obedience and identify his own will with the principle behind the law, the source from which the law sprang. And in a horrible, twisted way, it appears that Eichmann did precisely that, that he acted as though he was not only obeying the law, he was identifying his own moral will with the law. So much of the horribly painstaking thoroughness in the execution of the final solution, a thoroughness that usually strikes the observer as typically German, or else as characteristic of the perfect bureaucrat, can be traced to the odd notion, indeed very common in Germany, that to be law-abiding means not merely to obey the laws, but to act as though one were the legislator of the laws that one obeys. To act as though I myself have framed and given my entire moral consent to the law that I follow. And this is the distinction between law and order. An order is imposed upon me from without. I have to obey it because I am in a subordinate position, but I am not the source from which the order issues. But in the case of law, if I identify myself with the law, then I, as it were, see myself as at one with the legislator who framed the law. And this, in a way, is a perverse Kantian way of looking. So hence the conviction that nothing less than going beyond the call of duty will do. So it is not just that you have to follow the call of duty, which would make you obey your orders, but go beyond the call of duty and carry out what you see as the principle on which the order is based, the principle from which the law has been framed. Now this Arendt goes on to say, whatever Kant's role in the formation of the little man's mentality and journey may have been, there is not the slightest doubt that in one respect, Eichmann did indeed follow Kant's precepts. A law was a law, there could be no exceptions. In Jerusalem, he admitted only two such exceptions during the time when 80 million Germans had each his decent Jew. He had helped a half-Jewish cousin and a Jewish couple in Vienna for whom his uncle had intervened. This inconsistency still made him feel somewhat uncomfortable. And when he was questioned about it during cross-examination, he became openly apologetic. He had confessed his sins to his superiors. This uncompromising attitude towards the performance of his murderous duties damned him in the eyes of his judges more than anything else, which was comprehensible, but in his own eyes, it was precisely what justified him, as it had once silenced whatever conscience he might have left. Now, I will not, though, you know, it would be very, very nice to go through this extremely complex and wonderful chapter, but I will just take you to the end of the chapter, where and just read the last paragraph, and then I want to go on to two commentators on Eichmann in Jerusalem, who seem to me to place it in important contexts. So let's just look at the last paragraph first. And just as the law in civilized countries assumes that the voice of conscience tells everybody, "Thou shalt not kill." Even though man's natural desires and inclinations may at times be murderous, so the law of Hitler's land demanded that the voice of conscience tell everybody, "Thou shalt kill." Although the organizers of the massacres knew full well that a murder is against the normal desires and inclinations of most people. Evil in the Third Reich had lost the quality by which most people recognize it, the quality of temptation. This is why it is regarded as banal. Many Germans and many Nazis probably an overwhelming majority of them, must have been tempted not to murder, not to rob, not to let their neighbors go off to their doom, and not to become accomplices in all these crimes by benefiting from them. But God knows they had learned to resist temptation. Now, this very supremely ironic and brilliantly written chapter, and as I said, I would have loved to have read more of it, but I cannot now, I will stand back from it for a moment and sum up very briefly some of the main themes of Eichmann in Jerusalem, for which Hannah Arendt incurred the wrath of her contemporaries and became really persona non grata in Israel, though she did visit both Germany and Israel even before, before certainly after the writing of Eichmann in Jerusalem. She particularly important is the fact that she broke off her long friendship and association with Gershom Scholem through an acrimonious exchange, very sad, embittered exchange of mail and, you know, letters, that's to say written letters, after the publication of Eichmann in Jerusalem. And it was clear that for all that, you know, Arendt tried to explain her position, she was unable to explain herself to Scholem, and Scholem cut off intellectual companionship with her. And even to Mary McCarthy, even to many others, she found it very, very difficult to explain herself, though late in her life she wrote to Mary McCarthy that writing the book had made her feel lighthearted, as though a weight was off her conscience. Right. So let me just say what these themes are, and I want to turn to philosophers or commentators who have engaged, I think, very brilliantly with Eichmann in Jerusalem. One is Judith Butler, who wrote quite recently an opinion piece on Eichmann in Jerusalem in, I think, 2011. And I want to just very briefly look at some of the key concerns, the key issues raised by Judith Butler. And the other is Zala Benhabib, whose wonderful book, The Reluctant Modernism of Anna Arendt, I cannot recommend enough. It's one of the best books that I've ever read on a political philosopher. The Reluctant Modernism of Anna Arendt by Zala Benhabib. It's on your reading list. Let me just say what are the questions that Arendt seems to be raising, and I will turn to Benhabib, and then I'm turning to a longer set of extracts, because otherwise it's difficult to summarize. So the points that I'd like to make is that in the first place, Arendt is very critical of the Israeli state and the Israeli juridical process. And she's particularly critical of the legal apparatus of the trial. That is to say, what right does the Israeli state have to try Eichmann for his war crimes? And she certainly feels that these crimes are crimes against humanity, not crimes against the Jews, and therefore, I mean, in fact, she makes this distinction between what is a crime against the Jews and what is a crime against humanity. And therefore, she feels that a crime like genocide, which is a crime against humanity, should have been tried by an international tribunal. Secondly, there is this phrase, the banality of evil, and the way in which she characterizes Eichmann as unthinking or thoughtless. And this is a particularly difficult problem. This is where she says that the problem with Eichmann was that he did not think, was incapable of thought, or had somehow lacked the capacity. He was phenomenally stupid, that he lacked the capacity for reflective judgment, which makes the exercise of the Kantian rational intellect at all. And while she does not say that he was not guilty, he was guilty, and indeed she consents to his execution, she nevertheless regards him as in some way deficient in the power of thinking, the power of thought. And this was a difficult notion with which her readers to grapple with, because they thought that perhaps she was exculpating him, either in the way that junior officers are exculpated for following orders given by superiors, or as idiots or people in some way disadvantaged by the gifts of nature are unable to see the morality, to distinguish between good and bad of their actions, to see the morality of their actions. And thirdly, in the entire book in Eichmann in Jerusalem, while Hannah Arendt repeatedly takes issue very angrily with the prosecutor, and I forget the name of the prosecutor, but it'll come back to me, or maybe it'll emerge in these pages that I have, further pages that I have photocopied. She takes issue with the Israeli prosecutor for repeatedly asking persons who were on trial why they did not resist. And she understands that it was not possible to resist, that there are problems in resistance. Like, for example, the murder of Heydrich leads to the killing of, let's say, 100 to 200 or 300, 500 people. So resistance is not so easy. She makes a point of this, and she takes issue with the fact that the prosecutor is asking a question that cannot be answered, that it should not be answered. Nevertheless, she does mention repeatedly the role of the Jewish councils, what were called the Juden Räte, the special committees appointed by the Nazis with a decree of the 21st of September 1939, in the administration of the Jewish populations of Poland, the Baltic countries, and some parts of the Soviet Union, and their role in cooperating with the Nazis in the carrying out of the final solution. And she indeed, at certain points, appears to say that some of these councils, especially where they were Zionist in persuasion, were working towards the same end as the Nazis. They wish to see Jewish people leave Germany or lands held by Nazi occupation. They cannot have wanted that the Jewish people be exterminated, but they appear to have collaborated in the removal of the Jewish people from these lands. Now, while the roles of the Jewish councils, naturally this was a very sensitive subject, the fact that Arendt repeatedly mentioned it was regarded as offensive to many, and it was, there was a further problem about the extent of her knowledge, whether she had sufficient knowledge on which to base her opinions, and there has been there have been newer revisions and new editions of Eichmann in Jerusalem in which it's been argued that she didn't have access as a reporter on the scene, as it were. She didn't have access to enough information, and there was a great deal that later came out which would have perhaps changed her opinions to some extent. So these are the matters on which this work became, because of which this work became controversial, and it is important that we remember that the work is not just chapter 8, but a larger, considerably larger work in which these other issues also repeatedly come up. Particularly, however, in chapter 8, I think it is the issue of thoughtlessness, or the question of whether the thinking individual is a prerequisite in order to carry out, in order to perform, as it were, moral actions. This is an important point, and I think it's a point that is raised by the talk of Kant at the start. Now, as I said, while it's possible that I could, I could spend more time simply discussing these questions, but I want briefly to refer to these two important philosophers, Judith Butler and Zaila Ben-Habib. And I think I would like to start with Butler, because Butler's essay is actually relatively quite small. And I'll just summarize what Butler says and how Butler tries to bring out what she sees as the essence of Arendt's work here in this text. Now, Butler is asking, what does Hannah Arendt mean by the banality of evil? What does it mean as a phrase? And she says that there are two challenges to legal judgment here. One is that of legal intention. Did the courts have to prove that Eichmann intended to commit genocide in order to be convicted of the crime? Her argument was not this. She said that Eichmann may well have lacked intention, in the sense that he was incapable of thought. We are returning to this problem of being capable or incapable of thought, insofar as he failed to think about the crime that he was committing. But she did not think that he acted without conscious activity. She does say that he knew his crime, he recognized it, and indeed he felt confused and muddled about it. So it is not that he did not know that the Jews were being killed and that killing people was a crime. It is not that. Nevertheless, she insisted that the term thinking had to be reserved for a more reflective mode of rationality. This is what Butler was saying. And Arendt wondered whether a new kind of historical subject had become possible with Nazism, with National Socialism, in which humans implemented policy but no longer had intentions in any usual sense. To have intentions, in her view, was to think reflectively about one's own action as a political being whose own life and thinking is bound up with the life and thinking of others. Now, here certain other important questions arise, which I will come to in the next part of what I will say after the break, which is Hannah Arendt's idea of the political being, about the plurality of the human sphere, about the nature of plurality, and then also, of course, what we will touch upon here, the nature of a totalitarian state. What is totalitarianism? What does totalitarianism imply? Now, by writing about Eichmann, says Butler, Arendt was trying to understand what was unprecedented in the Nazi genocide, not in order to establish the exceptional case for Israel, but in order to understand a crime against humanity. One that acknowledged the destruction not only of Jews, but also of other marginal groups like gypsies, like homosexuals, communists, and so on, disabled persons, ill persons. So the failure to think is a failure to take into account the necessity and value that makes thinking possible. So the destruction and displacement of whole populations was an attack not only on those specific groups, but on humanity itself. Now, Butler is sensitive to the problem that is this simply a naive view to take of thinking? Is this, to overvalue thinking? And is it way of constituting the human subject that is in some important respects unacceptable because it doesn't agree with our everyday reality? This Butler contests, and she argues that it is for all of us a duty to think of ourselves as one being among other beings. And this failure to think, Eichmann's failure, was a failure to realize that thinking implicates the subject in a sociality or plurality that cannot be divided or destroyed through genocidal aims. Right. Now, Butler's essay is a quite a short one, and I want to turn from here to Ben Habib, who discusses this whole, these problems with more care and in more detail. But I'd like to just draw your attention to what Butler says at the close of this short essay. And this is particularly important because of the context in which we are placing Hannah Arendt. This is the German intellectual tradition. Now, Butler says at the close of her essay, Arendt makes this distinction between practical reason and obedience. You remember, Eichmann had spoken of his duty of obedience but had not exercised his practical reason. In Eichmann in Jerusalem in 1963, and 7 years later, she began her influential set of lectures on Kant's political philosophy at the New School of Social Research in New York City. In a way, we can understand much of Arendt's later work, including her work on willing, judging, and responsibility, as an extended debate with Eichmann on the proper reading of Kant, an effort to reclaim Kant from its Nazi interpretation and to mobilize the resources of his text precisely against the conceptions of obedience that uncritically supported a criminal legal code and a fascist regime. And she goes on to say, in many ways, Arendt's approach is itself quite astonishing, since she is, among other things, trying to defend the relation between Jews and German philosophy against those who would find in German culture and thought the seeds of national socialism. And this is very much the kind of work that sees an obvious link, actually, between Heidegger and national socialism and so on. So, I mean, I think that there is a point that Butler is making here, the fact that she sees Arendt as trying to reclaim Kant for the German intellectual tradition, to reclaim him from these distortions and perversions, and to connect and see the place of Jews in German philosophy. In her way, in this way, her view, this is Butler again, recalls that of Hermann Cohen, who argued tragically in the early part of the 20th century that Jews would find greater protection and cultural belonging in Germany than in any Zionist project that would take them to Palestine. And this is because, Cohen argued, universality belonged to German philosophy. It was German philosophy that was particularly concerned with the idea of anthropological universality. And that this universality, which belonged to German philosophy, was better than internationalist or global models that might provide an alternative to the nation state. Arendt doesn't argue in the way that Cohen does, and certainly she has witnessed in her own lifetime events that make Cohen's naive belief in the universality of German philosophy laughable, perhaps. But she does, Butler says, reframe Cohen's project in new social and political philosophy, truly staying with Kant, or rather reformulating him for contemporary social and political philosophy in a true sense that would have stopped Eichmann and his cohorts, would have produced another kind of trial than the one that she saw in Jerusalem, and would have redeemed the German Jewish philosophical vocation, one that she tried to bring with her to New York. What had become banal was the attack on thinking, and this for her was devastating. Remarkable for us, no doubt, is Arendt's conviction that only philosophy could have saved those millions of lives. Now, this is Butler in her usual eloquent strain, but I wanted to say this simply because we need a kind of corrective to the obviously very negative and depressing effects of reading Eichmann in Jerusalem. But the other writer, who's also written, as I said, in a more detailed way on this text, and has written generally on Arendt's quarrel with modernity, is Laila Ben-Habib. She discusses Arendt's controversy with, you know, her quarrel or engagement, debate, whatever you want to call it, with Mary McCarthy. Mary McCarthy and Arendt exchanging letters to the effect that Eichmann was profoundly, egregiously stupid. Here I rather agree with Kant that stupidity is caused by a wicked heart. Now, Ben-Habib discusses the other issues in great detail. The question of the legality of the trial, the role of the Jewish councils, the questions raised by the prosecutor about resistance. This is Hausner, by the way. His name is Gideon Hausner in the Eichmann trial. Arendt said that, you know, these questions about resistance are cruel and silly. And she said that for her, writing on, reporting on the Eichmann trial was also a way of keeping faith with the memory of the Holocaust and its victims, not allowing this memory to be appropriated by the state of Israel. And this is an important question. She was confronted with the question, who spoke for the memory of the victims, if anyone at all? In what terms could one do so? Her attempt to retain a position outside the established organizations of the State of Israel and world Jewry got her into trouble. Who was she anyway? Where was she speaking from? This is a problem with the book as well. And this question of how does one retain a Jewish identity under the conditions of modernity, and what is modernity itself? Modernity for Arendt is very profoundly a state of loss. It is a state of destabilization, a state of the loss of tradition, the loss of community, the loss of moral law. And her quarrel with modernity is in this gradual erosion of what she sees as the moral sphere that we all inhabit. And her recourse to history, and she writes this in the essays Between Past and Future, is to recover, as she calls it, the lost treasure which we have somehow, which escapes us because of the pressure of the present, the pressure of a modernizing biopolitical sphere in which our ordinary humanity is in danger of being lost or eroded. Now, I think that, you know, because it's already 3:30, I should not spend too much time talking about Ben-Habib. I want to briefly turn to the further observations that I had wanted to make on the two other texts that I referred to in this first section of my discussion, This is On Violence, these are On Violence, and the earliest book, The Origins of Totalitarianism. I think that here, while I really wanted to read sections at least of this chapter, Total Domination, from The Origins of Totalitarianism, and I certainly want to look at On Violence, I will very briefly skim over what Arendt is saying here. And I will summarize in order to give you some idea of what is going on, and maybe if we have time, we can look at a few specific passages. So The Origins of Totalitarianism, let's take the earlier work first, was first published in 1951. And Arendt offers, and this is something that perplexes many of her critics, offers a new and relatively eccentric view of what totalitarianism is. The work is divided into three sections, anti-Semitism, imperialism, and totalitarianism. For us, in our historical place and time, it is of importance that Hannah Arendt saw very clearly the links between modern totalitarianism and imperialism. And she said that the seeds of totalitarian behavior, totalitarian power structures, are laid by imperial adventures, particularly, obviously, European imperial adventures in Africa and Asia. And she made this very clear, not only in this early work, but also in later writings, right up to the end of her life in 1975. Secondly, in this work, she is talking about Nazism and Stalinism as two versions of totalitarianism. Now, the problem here is that they are obviously not the same. And she recognizes that they are not the same, that they arise from, not just from different historical circumstances, but from different ideologies, from different kinds of conviction, different forms of what we might call mass paranoia. Different forms of mass paranoia. So though she sees these differences, she recognizes also that sometimes the results are rather similar. And in The Origins of Totalitarianism, she frames a theory about totalitarianism, which I think, despite its eccentricity, despite its novelty for its time, has proved incredibly influential and is certainly very much the major work with which Giorgio Agamben's Homo Sacer is in debate right through. I mean, if you think of what Foucault and Agamben are doing in their work, they are, I think, conducting a kind of they're engaged in a kind of intellectual exchange, a kind of intellectual debate with Agamben, particularly about the emergence of this. The man who cannot be sacrificed but can be killed. He can be killed but cannot be sacrificed. Right. Now, what does Arendt say in The Origins of Totalitarianism? She says that this is an entirely new phenomenon. That is to say, it is not just some ancient form of government which we can find in Aristotle, for example. She says that everything we know of totalitarianism demonstrates a horrible originality. Its very actions constitute a break with all our traditions. So totalitarianism illustrates the human capacity to begin, the power to think and to act in ways that are new and contingent. And moreover, it is rooted in a certain aspect of modernity. What is this? She calls it modern man's deep-rooted suspicion of everything that he did not make himself. So, believing that everything is possible, totalitarian movements demand unlimited power, But what this turns out to mean is not the building of utopia, but unparalleled destruction. Experiments in total domination in the concentration camps, which are the laboratories of the new regimes, gradually make it clear that the price of total power is the eradication of something that Arendt herself values very much, which is human plurality. So a total terror as practiced in the camps is the essence of totalitarian government. It doesn't simply kill people, but first eradicates their individuality and their capacity for action. Precisely because man's resources are so great, and I'm quoting Arendt here, he can be fully dominated only when he becomes a specimen of the animal species man. And those of you who have not read Arendt but have read Agamben will remember what Agamben is also saying, something like that. That he can be fully dominated when he is just an animal. He is just a one more member of the species, the human species. And she goes on to say that in her view, totalitarianism doesn't have a utilitarian purpose. It doesn't have a real ideology. It is not directed towards some kind of identifiable purpose. Its purpose is power. Its purpose is power is itself sui generis, that's what she says. And its purpose is to crush out all symbols of human resistance. The gigantic apparatus of terror is therefore superfluous. The apparatus seems superfluous to you because it serves to make men superfluous. Right. And this is there's a lot here on the totalitarianism generally. And the problem of the distinction between Nazism and Stalinism is something that Arendt does consider, but she, as I said, she comes to the conclusion that it is ultimately the result is the same. It is in the context of totalitarianism where one man's order becomes law, that a deeply criminal activity, or series of a course of activity, that course of actions, as carried out by Adolf Eichmann, can become possible because there is no distinction for him or in his mind between the order of an individual and what is conceived to be law. And because he has become incapable of applying his rational intelligence to making a moral distinction between right and wrong and argue that law must come from somewhere. And where does law come from? Now, this, of course, is in a way a Kantian antinomy also, because if you look at the third antinomy in Kant, Kant says the third antinomy is that causality is in accordance with natural laws is not the only causality from which all the phenomena of the world can be derived. To explain these phenomena, we have need of another causality, that of freedom. That's the antinomy of freedom. And the antithesis to this is there is no freedom. Everything in the world takes place in now, this question of whether or not there is freedom is, I think, related to how human subjects behave in a totalitarian state. The other essay that I wanted to discuss, but I really am not going to have time to do, because I do want to leave some time for further discussion from this very learned audience, is the essay on violence, which I've circulated. And you may remember that Walter Benjamin also wrote a famous short essay called Critical Violence. And Benjamin there also was interested in the way in which the state legitimizes or arrogates all violence to itself and takes away the capacity for violent or the right to act violently from individuals. in this particular section, section 2 of On Violence, which I have circulated, Arendt is more interested in violence as related to power. And she says, in more or less the middle of this essay, it is a rather sad reflection of the present state of political science that our terminology does not distinguish among such key words as power, strength, force, authority, and finally violence. And she says that there is actually a great deal of terminological indefinition, lack of definition, between these words, power, strength, force, authority, and violence, all of which, to her mind, refer to distinct and different phenomena and would hardly exist unless they did. And in such a situation, it is always tempting to introduce new definitions, but what is involved is not merely a matter of careless speech. Let us look very briefly at her definitions. What does she, how does she define these terms? And I will leave it at that. Power corresponds to the human ability not just to act, but to act in concert. Power is never the property of an individual. It belongs to a group and remains in existence only so long as the group keeps together. Strength unequivocally designates something in the singular and individual entity. It is a property inherent in an object or person. Force, which we use often in our daily speech as a synonym for violence, should be reserved for the forces of nature or the forces of circumstance. This is the same way in which Benjamin uses force in critical violence. Authority, relating to the most elusive of these phenomena, and therefore as a term most frequently abused, can be vested in persons, and so it can be delegated. Violence, finally, is, as I have said, distinguished by its instrumental character. Phenomenologically, it is close to strength, since the implements of violence are designed and used for the purpose of multiplying natural strength. It is particularly tempting to think of power in terms of command and obedience, and therefore to equate power with violence. But, she says, no government exclusively based on the means of violence has ever existed. Even the totalitarian ruler requires a power basis, the secret police and its net of informers. Only the development of robot soldiers would eliminate the human factor completely and permit one man with a push button to destroy whomever he pleased. So, in a sense, by distinguishing power from violence, it is possible to see that power is not only not only identified with violence, it can be possessed without necessarily having recourse to violence. Now, finally, she has some observations to make about non-violence. In a head-on clash between violence and power, the outcome is hardly in doubt. If Gandhi's enormously powerful and successful strategy of non-violent resistance had met with a different enemy, Stalin's Russia, Hitler's Germany, even pre-war Japan instead of England, the outcome would not have been decolonization, but massacre and submission. This is one of the most controversial things said by Hannah Arendt, and I'm therefore quoting it to you. However, England in India and France in Algeria had good reasons for their restraint. Rule by sheer violence comes into play where power is being lost. It is precisely the shrinking power of the Russian government internally and externally that became manifest in its solution of the Czechoslovak problem, that is to say, the Prague Spring. Just as it was the shrinking power of European imperialism that became manifest in the alternative between decolonization and massacre. So, to sum up, politically speaking, it is insufficient to say that power and violence are not the same. Power and violence are opposites, where the one rules absolutely, the other is absent. Violence appears where power is in jeopardy, but left to its its own course, it ends in power's disappearance. This implies that it's not correct to think of the opposite of violence as non-violence. To speak of non-violent power is actually redundant. It's a really remarkable set of observations here. I end by saying that but I do not mean to, that's what she says here, I do not mean to equate violence with evil. I only want to stress that violence cannot be derived from its opposite, which is power, and that in order to understand it for what it is, we shall have to examine its roots and nature. Now, the point that, the reason why I chose this is that we need to understand the totalitarian state, according to Arendt, as based not upon, as based not upon violence directly, but upon power. And she suggests that the totalitarian state, so long as it holds power, can do anything. And in such situations, the exercise of strength or force does not even appear like violence. The final solution does not even appear like violence. It requires a furious, pacific kind of nature, as it were. But when it is met with resistance, it is at that point that violence is opposed to power, and it is at that point that power is lost, because it is it comes head to head, as it were, with its opposite, which is violence. Thank you.
So it is now 15 minutes. We have to break for refreshment at 4:05. So this.
When Arendt was talking about violence and non-violence, she did have Gandhi's
yes.
in the background, and yet she says non-violence is redundant, and its power is redundant.
She says, let me just go back to that. It was quite a complicated passage, actually. And in fact, this whole essay on violence is written as a series of philosophical paradoxes, which is a very, it's a favored mode for many continental philosophers. So what does she say here? She says that in a head-on clash between violence and power, the outcome is hardly in doubt. That is to say, she seems to think that violence will win over power. Now, if Gandhi's enormously powerful and successful strategy of non-violent resistance had met with a different enemy, Stalin's Russia, Hitler's Germany, even pre-war Japan instead of England, enormously powerful and successful strategy of non-violent resistance. That suggests that Gandhi has power, moral power, the power of the millions who follow him, but he is not using violence. However, she feels that if it had been countered with violence, let us say wholesale, say genocide, or mass massacres of large portions of the population and so on, then Gandhi would have lost power. That is what she seems to think. Whether this is so or not, we cannot know. It may be that her own experience of the Holocaust was what led her to say this. Because, while it is a gross simplification of the Holocaust to say that the Jews did not resist, and this is a problem that keeps coming up in Arendt's studies and needs to be corrected. Nevertheless, it is true that in a sense, this large population of 6 million Jews who were killed during the Holocaust were non-violent. That is to say, they did not assume violence as a means of rectifying or changing their fate. And faced with the violence of the state, they were exterminated. And that violence, because it was exerted upon them by a regime that was supremely powerful, though, according to Arendt's reading, on the point of losing its power, you know, becoming less and less powerful, it masqueraded, or it appeared almost as simply an extension of power, that, you know, one can, if you have the power to kill a cockroach, I don't really consider it a violent act. You might think that it's not a violent act. But it is, of course. I mean, it's a complicated question. However, here, she's speaking of Gandhi as having power, but not using violence.
It's also controversial when examples are made of
Gandhi
saying, resist the Nazis.
Yes. Right. Absolutely. Yes.
He must have said that those
controversial. Yes, I think so. You're quite right. Yes, that Arendt's view is something that arises out of this particular view. Yes, it's
just.
It was fascinating. Thank you. I was just wondering about this reluctant modernism.
Yes.
Since we perhaps can safely say that modernism also somewhere indicated the problematizing of the entire tradition of idealism, is there any relationship between Nietzsche and the position of Arendt here regarding this entire question of, or rather the anxiety and skepticism with the tradition of idealism, which we find in Nietzsche, and which you perhaps is indicating.
Okay. Right. Thank you very much for that question, very serious and thoughtful one. I will not say very much about Arendt's relation to Nietzsche, but it is true that while Arendt could be accused of a kind of essentialism, and, you know, because of the nature of her writings on the human condition, very large and important book, The Human Condition, her use of classical ideas like the vita activa, the vita contemplativa, etc., she seems to be departing a little from that kind of skeptical, anxiety-ridden form of continental philosophy that leads to, let's say, Derrida and so on. But at the same time, it has been argued that she learned from Martin Heidegger the techniques of a kind of deconstruction or dismantling of Western philosophy, and that her critiquing of some of the cardinal tenets of Western philosophy was in fact extremely strong, so that it would not be right to say that she is offering a simply idealist reading of human nature, or, you know, she is just saying that human beings have this or that capacity. There is a slight problem here, which I, you know, you're right in drawing attention to. About modernism, I have a problem myself with the title of Ben Habib's book, because I think that while Arendt is engaged in a lifelong critical debate with modernity and with modernity as a kind of intellectual, social project, which is inaugurated from the 17th century onwards, let's say, from the scientific revolution, let us say, and extends into the 20th century, while Arendt takes a position on this, her relation with that kind of cultural movement called modernism is slightly more nuanced. And I think that when she is engaged in using Benjamin's idea of fragmented subjectivity, when she is speaking of seizing upon the buried treasure of the past that she takes from Benjamin. I think that there she is really being influenced by modernism as the cultural movement of the 20th century. And I'm not speaking of this long history of modernity, I'm speaking of modernism as a particular cultural movement of her time in Germany and these exiled Jewish intellectuals in Paris and New York and so on. Question of reluctant modernism is a more vexed one than reluctant modernity. Yeah, when you think something that came to me and has now just suddenly gone. Yes, I was thinking of Jürgen Habermas's The Philosophical Discourse of Modernity, where he traces a long intellectual tradition, and in fact it would have been interesting if he had put Arendt into it, which he doesn't do. He doesn't. He speaks of many issues that are very important to Arendt. For example, the public sphere, dialogue, plurality, debate, man's a social animal, the zoon politikum, and so on. But it is strange that the Frankfurt School somehow avoid acknowledging it.
Thank you, ma'am, for the lecture. And this is not a question as such, but as someone who is trying to know Arendt a bit, and this is an observation that I would like to make, and I'd like to know your comment upon it. I would like you from something that you have said, that act of killing a cockroach is not violent, perhaps, according to
One
way of looking at it, but
yes.
At some it other, from some other
perspective, it is valid.
Obviously.
Very valid. So,
now, when Arendt is considering this figure of Eichmann as someone who is incapable to think,
yes,
perhaps this statement is problematic, because is it the fact that he's incapable to think, or whether inside a paradigm, the strategy of thinking that he's undertaking, the stupidity arises from a wicked heart.
Yes.
And in that paradigm, it is the strategy that he is choosing.
Yes.
And in another paradigm, where it is referring to Benjamin, it is unsanctioned.
Mm-hmm.
So I figure that it is a bit problematic to qualify Eichmann as a man who is incapable to think without thinking.
I agree with you, actually. This comment is very justified. Yes. And a lot of people would, you know. I mean, there is a huge problem. Mary McCarthy and... you know, it's as though Mary McCarthy is correcting Arendt's English. She's saying, don't use the word thoughtless. It doesn't mean what you think it means, you know. That maybe it's something else that you are trying to refer to. But, you know, the problem is that Arendt has a philosophical notion of what it means to think. And then she tries to argue that every being, if wishing to be thought human or to be part of the human world must exercise this capacity to think. It's also to do with what makes us a person. And I actually have many severe problems with that.
Should
I have grave problems.
Debate.
I think this whole, yeah, absolutely. The forensic notion of the human person. Which Locke argues in the Essay of Human Understanding. And, you know, this whole forensic notion of the human person has been a pernicious idea used by the West and by dominant groups in the West to argue for the non-person status, to give non-person status to slaves, women, animals, and so on, colonized races, and
perhaps,
so,
ma'am,
disabled persons.
Perhaps, ma'am, it's more about... As Zizek would say, it's more about knowing and acting rather than
yes.
being able to think.
Well, you see, this whole business of knowing also, I mean, it is a kind of human hubris that we are very worried about in this intellectual tradition. That as human beings, at some point or other, We are priding ourselves on an act, on acts of intellection, which we feel we are capable of, and animals, let us say, are not capable of. But we are also animals. What is the distinction between my thinking and a dog's thinking, or a dolphin's thinking, or an elephant's thinking? What is the distinction? We don't really know what the distinction is. This is only, there are only grades of thinking. Now, of course, Hannah Arendt tries to get around that by this argument of plurality, saying that, you know, harmony, plurality, we need to understand that we are only one of many, and that this we, this collective we, is made up of many individual I's, and each of them has a distinct, a right to have rights, a right to have rights. But nevertheless, there is a problem of the human being, which I, am uncomfortable with, and Arendt never really lived to see the whole development of the discourse of the post-human.
At the end of your lecture, I may have missed some point, but with reference to Arendt's concept of freedom,
yes,
you referred to the third antinomy by Kant.
Kant, yes.
And you mean to say that she is taking either the thesis or the antithesis of, she's supporting the thesis or the antithesis?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that she is interested in the situation in which this antinomy is genuinely exists, rather than just taking one side.
But so far as I know, Kant's intention was,
yes,
just to show that freedom is a concept,
yes,
which is not to be discussed through our theoretical reason.
Right. Just
in the area of the practical,
yes,
reason. Of course, reason is not in the second sense, but the second variety, second function of reason, the practical side. So, I think Arendt is not using that type of thinking.
No, not really. And there is a problem, I mean, again, as a philosopher, you put your finger on the knob. That, there is a, again, Arendt has been much criticized for, in a sense, confusing practical reason with reflective judgment. That she seems constantly to be speaking of reflective judgment in a way that gives too much importance to this, or too much place to gives priority to this act of reflective judgment, rather than the actual concrete practical reason as it is discussed in the critique of practical reason. There is a slight problem.
Maybe I'll talk to
you
later. Yes.
Sorry, if I may just go back a little bit, when you mentioned Gandhi and the way he was non-violent, and the situation would have been very different if confronted with by Nazi Germany. I mean, had Gandhi been confronted by a set. Quite apart from, the morality of the English as opposed to the Germans, etc.
Yes.
You see, the India was under a somewhat complex and untidy constitutional setup.
Yes.
There was the Secretary of State for India,
yes,
the Viceroy and Governor General, the governors of Madras and Bombay, who were somewhat independent of the Vice Governor General.
Yes.
They could correspond with the Secretary of State, the Commander-in-Chief, who did not report to the Viceroy but reported to the Secretary of State, and then Parliament and the Cabinet in London, Prime Minister. Now, all these are checks and balances, and I don't know how skillful, I mean, I really don't know whether Gandhi played off one against the other, which he could have, or anyone, an astute politician should have anyway, or could have. So you see, India was different then.
And it was not a totalitarian state.
It was not a totalitarian state. It continues till this day.
Yes.
So when people talk about genocide here, it's not quite that. There are instances of violence going on, but it's not totalitarian state in the way we have. Whether it be difficult situations have been handled. I mean, the Indian state has handled them. Maybe not to perfection, but it has handled them. That's fine. That's just fine.
Thank you.
First of all, I should confess that my reading of Arendt is quite fragmentary.
Yes.
But I am really enlightened by your discourse on Arendt. So, just a few comments. So, the way you have projected the distinction between power and violence that Arendt made. So, this Arendt's notion of power comes, in my reading, close to the Foucauldian notion of power or Gramscian notion of Hegel. What I would like to address that at the end of your reading of Eichmann in Jerusalem, you argued that what Kant was, what Arendt was basically trying to do is to reclaim Kant and reclaim the Kantian.
That's what Judith Butler says.
Judith Butler
reads this work in that way.
If you want to, is there any hint in Arendt's writings that if we put Arendt in a non-European setting or non-Eurocentric setting, because you know that if you have to conceptualize resistance, this claiming of the Kantian subject, so there are limits to that. So how do you situate the Arendt notion of freedom in a non-European setting or the which is not in an outside the domain of Enlightenment tradition. So, can you think of, is there any hint in Arendt's writings may at least propel us?
Thank you again for those questions. I think we might address some of them in the next section, because actually again here Arendt has been criticized for not talking enough about the nation state, about the new ways in which human communities set boundaries, what exists or what transpires beyond the boundary, what is the plight of refugees, of marginalized groups, of boundary crossers of various kinds. And all of this is constitutes a problem in reading late Arendt, very much, not so much the early Arendt, where because of the very, very powerful material that she is dealing with, and also the incredible attractiveness of her mind. Early Arendt is just, a delight to read, despite the length of the works. But late Arendt, those three works, Thinking, Willing, and Judging, or even The Human Condition, there are problems there. And you rightly ask about non-European subjects, and Arendt didn't say very much, for example, to where she could have, let's say, the Algerian War, other movements for decolonization. She says some throwaway comments like the comment on Gandhi, but she doesn't really offer extensive discussion of these matters. And, she, for example, has a brilliant article on the Hungarian occupation. She's writing on contemporary matters. She's writing on stuff that's happening in the 50s and 60s, but she's not writing in that way of decolonization at all, apart from connecting imperialism with totalitarianism. So